Okay, hello everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. Today our subject matter is adrenal dysfunction. My name is Dr. Laura Neville. I am a staff physician here at Labrix. We are the endocrine arm of Doctors Data. And we are so honored to be joined by Allie Miller. Allie Miller is a licensed and registered dietitian. She's also a certified diabetes expert with a passion for food as medicine. Allie, thank you so much for joining us here today.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I'm excited to be here.
Awesome. So let's dive right in. I think our functional medicine providers are probably very eager to peek behind the curtain and understand how you use food as medicine in your treatment for adrenal dysfunction. So you have a brand new book out. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah, the anti-anxiety diet.
Yes.
Within that book, you talk about the six R's. So I'm curious if you could give us just a background as to what those are.
Sure. So I really created the book after 10 years of clinical practice as a functional practitioner, always looking for the root cause. What is a trigger? What are the antecedents? And how can we resolve from the root? And I found that whether I was addressing leaky gut or inflammation or hormone imbalance, that anxiety or HPA axis imbalance is often the Achilles heel. So my book takes this premise and uses this kind of chicken and egg approach of six different functional entry points to driving causes of anxiety as well as root solutions to anxiety. So the R's include removing inflammation, so looking at removing pro-inflammatory foods. We look specifically within that at corn, soy, sugar, gluten, and also dairy because of the caseomorphin protein and that crossing the blood-brain barrier and playing a role with mood stability. And then also within that removing inflammation, I make the premise on a ketogenic diet by removing excessive carbohydrates. The next R is to restore balance in the microbiome. So it digs into the different strains of gut bacteria and what neurotransmitters are metabolized or produced in the biome based on the presence of varied bacteria strains. And then my next R looks at repairing gut integrity or gut lining. So addressing leaky gut, which can be a big component of blood-brain barrier impact for mood stability. The fourth R is restoring micronutrient status, looking at nutritional deficiencies, so mood stabilizing minerals, the role of B vitamins as cofactors for our neurotransmitters. And then the fifth and sixth, the most relevant of today's topic, the fifth is on rebounding your adrenals, and the sixth is on rebalancing our neurotransmitters.
Great. That sounds like a wonderful foundational approach. And let's talk about, you know, the meat of our subject matter today is that fifth R that you have on rebounding the adrenals. You know, in the medical profession, we do try to steer towards this term HPA axis dysfunction, as you mentioned. You know, I think for all of the people listening, we can all agree it's a mouthful, you know, and sticking to the term adrenal fatigue so much more easily rolls off the tongue. So we'll stick with that today. But do you want to tell us, Allie, so when you have a client in front of you and they're telling you about their symptoms, what clues you into really understanding and maybe considering adrenal fatigue in that person?
So it's both taking the information of their story of at what point of their lifespan are they presenting to me with, what external stressors have been present. So I practice virtually in Austin, Texas now, but my practice was grounded in Houston for 5 years. So a lot of people that dealt with Harvey, for instance, and had to evacuate from their homes, as a environmental or external driver, we know that when the body is under true survival mode and having to evacuate from your home and whatnot, that in itself sets us up for conditions for adrenal fatigue because we're truly running on adrenaline for a prolonged period of time. And there's so much unknown, and that's to the level of more extremes, right? So environmental distress, but even looking at people that have gone through divorce or even positive stress, like planning a wedding. So there can be varied drivers of stress. And unfortunately, I think that today's society, we don't allow enough, conversation of allowing ourselves to light that white flag of not surrender, but of needing help when we're wearing 7-8 different hats. full-time working mamas that are also trying to exercise and keep their body on track and whatnot. So symptoms that we typically see as adrenal fatigue or when the adrenal glands are overly taxed can be disordered sleep patterns. So individuals that are not waking well rested. So maybe they're falling asleep like a fly on the wall when they hit the pillow, they're out, but they're not waking well rested. Also, people that have adrenal insufficiency or imbalanced HPA axis can have insomnia. So they get that circadian disruption where they're waking in the middle of the night and then they start ruminating, or they wake naturally to maybe urinate or because their child woke them, but they're not able to get back into that deep circadian mode. So sleep disturbances is one. Digestive disturbances is actually a big one. And we often see a lot of my type A clients want to dig into FODMAPs and SIBO and stool testing, but often it's that secretory IgA that depletes, and that's a marker of our mucosal membrane integrity. And that tends to elevate with stress demand, but then over time get burned out. And we know that there's a huge connection of gut integrity and adrenal fatigue. So if we've been on high cortisol, cortisol can actually interfere with that secretory IgA and also can interfere with our LPS or our lipopolysaccharide, which also drives more gut permeability. So symptoms associated with leaky gut, whether it's bloating and distension, sensitivity to food causing actual GI like tenderness and cramping and irregularity in bowels can be very connected to an adrenal fatigue like symptom. And then generalized low energy, as well as hunger and sugar cravings, as well as salt cravings because of that aldosterone property of the adrenal glands. Often there's like a salt lick type desire where the individual has really intensive cravings for salt and or sugar. And then we can also see mood disturbances. And when someone is in an overdrive reactive mode, we can see, I call it incredible Hulk syndrome. We see this when people are high DHEA often, where they kind of are just having this physiological tension and irritability or short fuse. And then as the adrenals get further depleted, we can even see a flat affect mimicking depression. And anxiety can be seen on both ends of the spectrum of both excessive or insufficient output.
Yeah. So what I hear you saying is, almost, so many people I can imagine fit in this description. Unfortunately, the symptoms are so common, but really, really good assessment, I think, that you accomplish when you're talking to someone, really artistically taking that story of years and years of incidences, even if they're not huge, like Hurricane Harvey, but something, like a wedding, as you mentioned. So interesting that all of that can be related to adrenal dysfunction. Wonderful. So once you've established some symptoms that you might understand as adrenal fatigue or adrenal dysfunction, what testing do you then proceed with?
So the gold standard, really, and even acknowledged by the Journal of Endocrinology, is salivary assessment at a 4-point assessment for cortisol values. And I like to look at also DHEA at that same time as a salivary assessment. And then I like to take into account the neurotransmitters made by the adrenal glands as well. So the dopamine, norepinephrine, and epinephrine. And I find that very clinically relevant. I look at those neurotransmitters in the urinary metabolites. And I find it very clinically relevant because someone can be stressed and wired, yet stressed and tired, or vice versa. And I like to be very mindful if I'm using adrenal glandular compound that individual does not have extreme epinephrine levels. Sometimes when they're on high output of the neurotransmitters of the adrenals, we would clinically address that differently or want to ensure that we're providing something like L-theanine, which is going to help with that alpha brainwave and help to reduce that fight or flight output as an excitatory neurotransmitter as you're rebounding the adrenals. And I always like to take into account adaptogens. But based on those levels, it's important to look at both DHEA and cortisol for that same reason, that someone could be low cortisol, but maybe very high DHEA. So you would want to be strategic in the way that you support that rebound, but not overstimulating the whole cortex.
Sure. Great. Wonderful. Wonderful approach. And you've mentioned quite a bit of the treatment. Do you have any kind of go-to starting point from a nutritional standpoint or supplement-wise? You mentioned L-theanine, but anything else come to mind?
So nutritionally, the first thing that we look at is really giving a potent amount of delivery of vitamin C. Vitamin C is actually highest stored in the tiny adrenal glands. And, you know, we talk about the benefits of vitamin C for collagen production for skin. We talk about vitamin C in its immunological systems of support. But vitamin C is a huge component of helping with cortisol metabolism on, again, both appropriate if high or low in your cortisol output. So this is something that I use with both a food as medicine intervention as well as supplemental support, and something that you can do pretty soundly as a foundation. So for foods, we'd be looking at things like, we often think of citrus, which would be included in that world, but taking citrus to the next level, selecting your organic citrus and zesting it is going to give you a lot of a nice concentrated form of those bioflavonoids and that super potent vitamin C. You're also going to get rutin in the bitter pith if you do microplane or grate it down all the way to that pith. And there's so many anti-inflammatory benefits in rutin, which helps to protect also the integrity of that gland. So we'll use that zest in like salad dressings, or even just to add to our water as a really nice aromatic infusion and getting more kind of bang for your buck out of that citrus fruit, which you could also consume. And then we use things like roasted bell peppers, which is also a very good potent source of vitamin C. And most produce in general in its fresh form is going to have some vitamin C. So ensuring that the individual is getting their 7 to 9 cups of fruits and vegetables is a very sound foundation to get that benefit. And then for vitamin C supplement, we think of something that's buffered, which is going to help with bowel tolerance, because we know vitamin C, when we go above 2 grams or so, we can start to get a little bit of looser stools.
Sure. Yeah. Wonderful. I'm salivating here just talking about all of the delicious fruit. What about lifestyle support beyond kind of those nutritive and supplement ideas?
Sure. So another one I feel like I have to address before lifestyle is adaptogens, because they're just such a fantastic tool. I truly feel that the only way I am able to be a super mama that has a 2-year-old and a full-time clinic and just wrote a book is because of adaptogens. So I just need to throw that out.
Yay for adaptogens.
I'm talking about rhodiola, ashwagandha, cordyceps. Yes. Adaptogens help us to adapt to stress demand without digging deep into those adrenals as first line of defense. And adaptogens, by their nature and the definition of an adaptogen, does not have any toxic level. You may still want to look at your medication load, as far as some of them do have some indications that would be a contract. But they're very safe and can be dose dependent and can provide us that energy that we need from stress-induced fatigue and help us to be resilient, so we're not hyper-reactive, drinking down into those poor adrenal glands. So you can do them in food or supplement form as well. Like Tulsi tea is holy basil tea. Doing that as an infusion with your citrus would be a good synergy 2-for-1. And I have a recipe in my book called A Stress Busting Steamer, and that uses ashwagandha powder with cayenne and maca and cinnamon and an egg yolk that is whisked into full fat coconut milk as it's simmering low heat. Mm-hmm. And it's phenomenal, really creamy and dreamy and gets you all the goodness.
Yeah, sounds amazing. I love that one. Yeah.
So lifestyle support, you know, the biggest things I think, as far as one of the first ones I look, is over-exercising. So often, and exercise in its concept is healthy, but unfortunately, a lot of people that are dealing with adrenal insufficiency or HPA axis imbalance, because they're feeling so flat, they want that high intensity training, that spin class, that, you know, CrossFit, things that throw the body into a cortisol surge mode, which can only further perpetuate that depletion. So you get that short fuse of that juice that you feel so flat from, but that can sometimes hinder the healing process. So my first line of defense is to really watch the overexercisers and transition them to more mindful, gentle movers that allow their body one space that they can definitely control to reduce that stress impact. And that would be like a physiological stress impact, because many of us, unfortunately, can't always change our work environment or the fact that our two-year-old woke us up or the other variables.
Yes.
So that's right. A big one.
Good, good. If you have, I mean, those are wonderful. I think it's great that you mentioned those over-exercises, right? Because we can just assume that, you know, exercise is good for us, you know, why not? Of course, we're all taught to exercise and to move our body, and more is better, right? And that's not always the case. So wonderful point that you brought up.
Yes.
Just to bring this to life, do you have any particular cases that come to mind at the forefront that you'd like to share with us? Any clients that you've worked with that stand out to you?
Sure. So I work with a lot of women. I do work with men as well, but I work with a lot of women, and many of them are in either intensive careers or are juggling many hats. And so one of the common cases is actually an overexerciser mama. So kind of already preset the stage, I guess. Yeah. But Julie was working with me for bloating and distension, and she came in wanting to do a candida cleanse and had done a quiz and felt that that was the right delivery. So, you know, I supported her with berberine, and we used Saccharomyces boulardii and a whole protocol and supported her body, yet the bloating and distension didn't change. And she was also starting to have interrupted sleep patterns. She was doing a ketogenic diet, and I am a proponent, generally speaking, of a keto diet, but she was doing a keto diet but wasn't getting any blood ketone values, and she wasn't getting that keto high. She was feeling very flat affect, and so I decided to do some advanced testing with her. We did the salivary cortisol assessment with, we did the, actually the whole neurohormone complete plus panel, so we looked at sexual hormones, cortisol, DHEA, and her neurotransmitters. And we did see that actually, as far as phasing with her cortisol, she was in a phase two, but that her DHEA was less than 50. So she was in a very low state of DHEA. And when she was trying to do the ketogenic diet, the production of ketones requires DHEA as a precursor. So many people don't know that. And because it's become so buzzworthy, many people can nullify that by taking exogenous ketones, but still that metabolic process becomes very taxed. And so it is an important biomarker to monitor. So we did work with adrenal glandular and an adaptogen formula, and we did strategic, we actually brought her out of the ketogenic diet for a 12-week window to start to kind of reset her body. And then we allowed herself to go back into keto for a period of time. Once we had retested her DHEA to be at 150, we used supplemental DHEA as well, a 25 milligram extended release. So at that point, her entire experience with diet was completely different. Once she had that lighter fluid to build the ketone bodies, she started experiencing the benefits. She did lose 8 pounds of belly fat. She did see improved sleep patterns. She felt like that brain fog that was so heavy of a cloud that she was almost paralyzed by often, getting stuck in the middle of Whole Foods, not sure of what she was even grabbing, really lifted. So this cloud lifted on her cognitive and energy level. And she also got some of her stubborn weight loss off by loosening up. So less exercise, more eating, and rebounding the adrenals. And we also really focused on her sleep. A lot of that kind of type of clientele is an over-exerciser, an under-sleeper, and an over-caffeinator. Caffeinator. So I did pull her to limit to 8 to 12 ounces of coffee only, because she was doing like 2 or 3 cups and she was doing prolonged fasting. So we brought in eggs for breakfast, only 8 ounces of coffee. And we switched up her exercise to yoga and walking with friends. And we brought in blue blockers for sleep time and practiced some sleep hygiene. So she was at least getting 7 hours a night, because she was running on about 5.
Yeah, wonderful. Such a great example of an individualized approach, right? Some of our clients and patients can get really excited and try to do all of these things on their own because they read about them. But really that shows you, it's a perfect example of how it needs a bit more of an individualized approach. So you were able to do that with her. I'm sure she was very, very thankful to be feeling so much better.
Yes, yes. And the bloating that she thought was yeast distension ended up resolving as the adrenal gland rebounded, because often, like I said, there's that big intimate connection of that inflammation in the gut as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So I wanted to share with everyone a bit about your recipes. Everyone listening, Allie's book is chock full of amazing recipes. There's about 100 pages of them. So very good amount there. Page 204, I'm curious. I saw that one. It looked delicious. It's called the Anti-Inflammatory Electrolyte Elixir. So if you would mind talking a little bit about that and how it might help to rebound the adrenals, as you do that, I'm going to pull that up on the screen so everyone can see the recipe.
Awesome. Awesome. So this actually was established in my virtual food as medicine ketosis class preceding the book, for that very reason that many people need additional adrenal support when they're doing a low carbohydrate diet, especially a very low carbohydrate diet to produce ketones. And often also we get electrolyte instability, which people call the keto flu. So this was actually developed as a tool for my keto clients, but it's a great recipe that I included in my book for the reason that it's very potent in vitamin C. So it uses turmeric root and it uses 3 lemons. And so with the lemons, we actually keep the white pith intact. You actually peel the lemons, you zest them first and reserve that zest. And then you peel the lemon and you blend the entire lemon in the blender with that white pith to get all of those bioflavonoids with 5 cups of filtered water, 1 cup of coconut water to get the electrolytes there, and then a teaspoon of Himalayan salt and 2 inches of turmeric root. And so it makes this beautiful, as you can see from the picture, glowing colored beverage that provides us a good electrolyte stability, supports our liver in detoxification, and provides that potent punch of vitamin C to tonify the adrenal glands.
Awesome. That looks so wonderful. I can't wait to try it. I'm going to do that as soon as possible.
It's like the best natural Gatorade because it does have that salt in there, you know, so you have to be prepared to know that that's coming, but it's fantastic after a long weekend or after an exercise session. Really fantastic. And you can take it as like a shooter and you can make it more concentrated in that sense, or you can drink it as a beverage.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Allie. Thank you for all of the amazing information for all of our participants. Please enjoy that recipe. And also remember to consider Allie's book, The Anti-Anxiety Diet, as a resource for both you and your patients. We need all of the support we can get in treating adrenal dysfunction. It's absolutely pervasive across the population. And so the more tools we have, the better. You can find Allie's book on Amazon and also on her website at alliemillerrd.com. And we'll provide the links to that in the comments below. Again, thank you everyone for joining us. We're going to see you again very soon.
Thank you, Dr. Laura.
Thank you.